when you're ready.
Hello, my name is Eike Marfa. I'm an artist living in Berlin, and I mainly do film, and I'm recently also doing a PhD in Gothenburg at the university there. Okay, and my talk is called Machine Companions, Exploring Non-Human Perception, Temporalities and Expressions. I think it kind of might, or I felt the connection to the previous, the one to your presentation pretty much, and let's see how we can maybe discuss it. Research needs objects and apparatuses for investigation, but usually forgets them when it retrospectively constructs objectivity. Karen Barrett refers to this as a quantum entanglement between the object and the agencies of operation, the agencies of observation. Thank you. With the help of the film Brenders, Ganglers, and Kiso's machines, each part welcomes the other without seeing, I will trace how research tools are to be understood as intensive ecological and relational forces, or even better, machine companions. First, I will describe some of the details of the film, which I shot in Cuba from 2011 to 2013. And I start with the title that we just saw. The Spanish term prenda can be translated as pledge or pawn. It describes a cauldron that contains a collection of materials central for palo. Palo is a modern Cuban invention. It is a sorcery technique or a healing practice influenced by Congolese linguistics and aesthetics and by the forced individualization brought about by colonialism and slavery. To come into being, a prenda requires a collection and a careful composition of often formless materials. They stem from mountains, forests, fields, and riverbeds, from the floors of the house, from human, animal, and plant remains, and can be made of crafted objects too. It seems relevant to underline that neither the structure nor the substance of the materials are important. It is rather the weaving of a relational texture of places, objects, and bodies that is significant. Imagine from powerful compositions into which all the different parts enter, a prenda forms unlimited connections and often unforeseeable effects. which then influence the life of the Ganga or the healer and his or her customer. In some way, the dead are in kisos, and their properties also play a part. They are activating the milieu. They are, as the anthropologist Todd Ramon Ochoa says, best imagined as an uncountable spreading, quote end. A prenda activates and binds people, animals, plants, and matter, and linguistic materials into a multiplicity, a machine with a lot of relations to the outside. Consider for a moment that you are a charged object. Become indifferent to what usually is mutually exclusive, namely object and subject classifications, for example. A prenda is an individualized singularity charged with countless relations constituted by pre-individual matter that contains life and death with all its material and conceptual forces. Ochoa's acknowledgement of the assemblage is compelling. He writes, I quote, prendas, gangas, and kisos are certainly not objects as they exist in a dialectical universe of subjects who act and control, and objects that receive action and only submit to control. They are far too active in revaluation for this to be the case. Quote end. By this, Ochoa provides a penetratable and accessible understanding of persons and things. Matter reacts to the environment. It is equipped with a feature that allows all matter to reproduce itself and develop components for dynamic modifications, to be producer and product at once. Like plants and animals, or forests and landscapes, matter organizes, memorizes, and creatively produces territorial assemblages. Similar to swarm behaviors, bacterial communications, and other forms of organization, both natural and artificial matter arranges itself within its environment. Deviating from Marx's materialism with a strong attachment to Deleuze, the metaphysics of new materialism addresses inorganic matter as being capable of multiplying in a manner similar to morphogenesis described in biology. The discussion evoked by Manuel de Landa, Rosa Predotti, Karen Barrett, and others acknowledged that these processes have agency. Matter, neither determined by identity nor passive essence, but instead inventive, excitable, and productive, traverses human activities and achievements. A new materialist film practice, how I understand it, is entangled and immersed in the movement of disparate materials in various ways. It acknowledges the involved materials, apparatuses, and their agencies, documenting and transforming the world in the same time. Film as a new materialist practice creates an awareness to the vitality of the so-called inanimate and its processes as an ecological connective force. It relates to the non-human as an active participant rather than a passive object of inquiry. This requires more than just mastering or observing the material processes. It requires active participation and involvement in the mutations of matter from the practitioner. I've learned from the affective forces and expressive qualities of matter itself, how to take serious the process of matter. Not only does matter select what is necessary for its reproduction, it also expresses the need for new encounters. Or said differently, Matter exchanges matter by the way of becoming other. Thus filming turns into a process homologous to the construction of a crystal or a snowflake, capable of producing geometric configurations, or a plant that is able to produce flowers by contracting matter in response and as an excitation for its surrounding. The plane of material challenges ontological definitions and epistemological constructions and creates new onto-epistemological assemblages. Be it a rock, a dog, a bottle, a planet, a bacterium, or a potted plant. If one stops tying oneself to the idea of being human, one may as well cross boundaries with inactive things, entering processes, developing capacities that unfold within certain existential modalities that might have nothing to do with life. Linking animism with William James' radical empiricism, Isabel Stengers draws attention to the practice of magic known from the everyday, such as the magic of a landscape or an event. Neither a trope nor a metaphor, this magic is an art of participation. It is doing its thing entirely without our contribution, while we are still taking part in it. When acting under the premise of becoming with, where one has to change for the other to become, filming can carry forward such everyday magic, as Stengers speaks of. Film, based on the middle of the animate and the inanimate, magnifies ongoing processes and forces and puts itself in relation to them. Understanding the world as an immediacy rather than a still life to contemplate, similar to Sigurd Bertholdt's Kinoglas, turns film into an extremely lively endeavor, and as it accounts for change and alteration. The camera, for example, is undoubtedly a moving body with expressive capacities, rather than just a cultural or technical device. It maintains a state of constant change and becoming. continually shifting in and out of focus, the camera cannot be easily stratified into one aesthetics, one time, or one color grading, or one pace. It activates heterogeneous sensations of colors, lights, landscapes, and so forth when meeting and imprinting themselves in the film material. The camera is self-designing. It reaches and never keeps one movement or one effect throughout, but each effect and each movement, each bending of my mind is turning into an actual movement recorded by the camera. Producing symbiotic sensibilities in motion, the camera turns into a machinic companion. The sound, with its rhythmic whirls, enhances effects produced by the images and helps us to slide from one block of effects to the next. Even though the images and the sounds are always recorded together in situ, they nevertheless resist homogeneity. Sometimes they connect, sometimes they don't. Following their very own speeds, they run in and out of synchronization, yet always actualizing that what emerges. Chanting chickens, bumblebees, raindrops, bumble leaves, electro trains, each part of a polyvocality providing inhuman abstract rhythms for continuous movement. When considering relational practices, tools and blocks of technology exist in combination with what makes them possible. Connecting the organic and the inorganic in an interspecies liaison, tools cannot be treated separately from symbiosis. Neither a purely man-made cultural or technical device, nor to something that we dominate and objectify, or what dominates or enslaves us. Dusikovica describes them as intensive forces in environmental relations, by which one builds connections and transversal alliances. The question is not how advanced or elaborate any tools are, indicating different degrees of development, civilization, or distinction between human and non-human, but to understand them as a common and powerful ecological force. Among nations with the environment, which constantly generate new tools, new techniques, animating and activating the world. With such an approach to a film camera, a film camera becomes a toolless tool that might be different from animal tools, but which cannot be qualitatively judged or separated. The camera as an extension of already existing forces within an environment turns out to be primarily a capacity and a practice of ecology. Describing machinic relations or alliances with the environment, Deleuze and Guattari come up with the seductive phrase of machinic Füllung. Unlike the biological term of animal and plant Füllung, the machinic Füllung decodes kingdoms, classes, orders, families, and crosses them diagonally. The machinic Füllung is both natural and artificial, a destratifying transversality, as Deleuze and Guattari call it. It folds, unfolds, refolds organic and machinic matter into one another, creating a synthesis of heterogeneities, new inhuman composites, sensual material forces mutually transgressing and influencing one another. The machinic Füllung does not follow a certain direction or causal chain, as evolutionary biologists suggest in the case of plant and machine Füllungs, and as material culture describes an evolution of machines from stones to smartphones. Instead, the machine Füllung reverses causality, as Deleuze and Guattari say, and builds new appearances through random movements, but nevertheless completely synchronized with the environment. Considering this deep technological and ecological entanglement, evolution becomes a mainly mutual breaking of habits. collection, you could save it for the next.
It might be easier to actually do that. Yes.
Yeah, because we are already quite late now.
Yes.
Thank you very much.